Welcome back to the second episode of our interview with Michael Boogaloo Shrimp Chambers, the man who taught MJ the moonwalk and helped lay the foundation for some of MJ's other signature dance moves. In this episode, you'll find out why MJ said, "Consider it done," to Michael Chambers, and why Michael Chambers is grateful he did so to this day. Plus, he tells us what his last meeting with MJ was like. Take a listen. After checking out this podcast, go to www.boogalooshrimpdocumentary.com. That's www.boogalooshrimpdocumentary.com. Like you said, he was a student of, I think, the arts as a whole, dance, you know, yes, singing and stuff like that. Let me go back. So what year was the first year you actually met him for the first time? Oh, and what was that like?
The first year that I met Michael, mm-hmm, was 1982. And it was because 1982, I did a Channel 7 INLA did a thing on street dance.
Yes.
And I was dancing on Hollywood Boulevard. And Paul Moyer from Channel 7, he did like a segment on street dance.
Uh-huh.
So when they debuted the segment of street dance on Channel 7, somebody working for Channel 7, uh-huh, knew the Jackson camp. So they got my information and brought me and another dancer to the house on Havenhurst.
Right.
Just to show, we had like a makeshift audition. They just brought us from the streets to Encino. And uh-huh, Michael was like, "Okay, you guys ready? Here it is." And he showed us to Joe and Katie and Reeby was there, Janet was there.
Right.
You know, they were all doing what they do. And he brought us in that little studio behind the kitchen and we just did our little audition. And basically it was just, Michael introduced us to his dad and everybody else as the latest thing.
Right.
Because they had never seen that dance style in the rawness that we brought it. The thing is, they had seen it polished up from other performers.
Uh-huh.
But you gotta remember, they were very private and they didn't go to the clubs. And
right,
the stuff that we did in 82, it wasn't even on television. So when we were featured on that news spot, that was ground zero. And so Michael knew, okay, I need to get with this guy, and the other guy was Bruno Falcon.
Uh-huh.
So 1982 was when we first met, but it wasn't like, "Hey, how you doing? Hi." It wasn't that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
It was like, "Okay, you know, do something." So they brought us to the house, and we pretty much danced our butt off to show what we got. And what happened was, the best thing that happened,
mm-hmm,
right after that meeting,
mm-hmm,
we rekindled our relationship because I got a job with Lionel Richie and All Night.
Oh, long. Wow.
So we're just these kids from the streets, and somebody that was on that Channel 7 news crew brought us to Encino to show them this is what's happening.
Right.
But then what gave us more validity was now we auditioned for Lionel Richie for All Night Long.
Uh-huh.
And became Lionel Richie's principal dancers.
I saw.
On his 9-month world tour.
Right.
So by the time we got off that world tour, when we finished it at Universal Amphitheater,
mm-hmm,
Michael comes backstage in his best scarecrow outfit.
Uh-huh.
You know, he had an afro and a funky Steve Urkel suit, right, and glasses, yeah, but we knew it was him.
Uh-huh.
And the thing is, it made sense why he would have respect for us, because we were those guys that he's seen in the streets, but now we had a dignified position,
mm-hmm,
with his co-writer for We Are the World, Lionel Richie.
Right.
So you know what? I really like this puzzle being put together,
mm-hmm,
because it makes all the sense in the world why we're having this discussion. Michael did not just work with people who were novice. Michael worked and he looked at masters of their craft to become a master himself.
Right.
So we were masters of our craft,
mm-hmm,
but yet we weren't famous and we weren't so saturated by Hollywood. So by the time he worked out with us, when I say us, me and Bruno Falcon, who came out in Captain EO and Smooth Criminal,
right,
and went on tour with them, the thing, by the time he worked with me and Bruno, he was able to understand and interpret freestyle dance,
uh-huh,
and make the art of popping his own. So when you see his solos, I would say after 87, mm-hmm. when you saw him solo dance,
yes,
he became his own teacher. Because now that he had those techniques, he didn't need anybody to teach him.
Right.
He only needed people to introduce choreography to his dancers. But when it came to his solos, Michael had already mastered. He interpreted, okay, when I do a solo, I'm going to do this. That's how come he didn't just pop. He could go into jazz, he could do bop-bossy, he could do tap, he could do everything, but then he popped. So he mixed different styles when he did a solo.
Right. Absolutely.
Yeah, so he owned it. After 87, he got it. He didn't need nobody to teach him how to do something. He's like, okay, you know what? He could work out with you, but he became his own style of dancer. He mastered his own style.
Wow. You know, it just blows my mind that you were a kid and you were, I mean, at just in the place of such historical times in music and in dance. When you talk about like Lionel Richie, that tour that you went on, that was when Lionel Richie owned the world.
Yeah, and you know what's really cool, Dion? If you go back on YouTube,
uh-huh.
If you go on YouTube and you look up Lionel Richie Moonwalk AMAs, what we're discussing, you could really kind of put yourself in a time zone by watching that footage, because it was the year when Michael Jackson won all those awards.
Yeah, exactly.
And Lionel Richie performs all night long at the American Music Awards. Mm-hmm. But this is really interesting. When you look at the footage, Lionel Richie, he's on record saying that he taught Michael Jackson the moonwalk. He says it because, there it goes, I was Lionel Richie's principal dancer who actually helped introduce a new version of what people titled the moonwalk to Michael. So behind, backstage, Lionel and everybody else knew that Michael was working with these guys, me and these other guys. So Lionel said, okay, well, shoot. If these are my dancers, I'm going to take it. And sure enough, when Lionel Richie introduced Michael Jackson to that audience that became the We Are the World icons, right?
Right.
Lionel comes out and says, oh, you know what? I just taught this guy just like one thing, and he just went up into infinity. He got so famous. And so Lionel does his best moonwalk, and it's hilarious.
Right.
Because the joke is subtly true, because we worked with Lionel. So, you know what? It's really wonderful footage if you get a chance to see it, mm-hmm. since it's, you know, this is a timeline.
Mm-hmm.
That was ground zero, 1983.
Mm-hmm, yes.
1983 was ground zero of We Are the World, when we did All Night Long,
mm-hmm.
when Michael won for all of those, you know, Billie Jean, everything, and just went into infinity, you know, into his solo career. So, yeah, you know, I kind of felt like the freestyle hip-hop Forrest Gump, because I was always in the right place at the right time.
Absolutely. It was like, you know, I saw your documentary, and that was amazing, by the way.
Thank you.
Because it was so like, just knowing where you were, that you were basically, you had a front row seat to all of these kind of historical events in musical history. But then when we got to the point of talking, you were talking about like the backslide and what we now call moonwalk, and that you, in fact, was the person to introduce it, because all of these years, I had heard that someone else, and I'm not going to say the name, but someone else.
No, come on. Now look, I'm so humble than humble plow. Mm-hmm. For the record.
Yes.
Let's back up. Remember I said when I got into this game, I was a minor. I didn't have an agent. I didn't have a manager. I didn't have all these lawyers,
mm-hmm.
you know, documented. I just did what I did.
Right.
So check this out. We're talking 1983. All this really big stuff is happening.
Mm-hmm.
Michael wins Motown 25. You know, the word moonwalk is out there. Everybody's going bananas. You know, all this stuff, right?
Right.
Well, 1984, I started my first movie as Turbo. Right after all that craziness,
mm-hmm.
after 83, I starred in the movie Breaking in 1984 at Canon Films. That
right.
just went and launched a whole new era of hip-hop, right?
Exactly.
So, I wasn't really worried about the credit of teaching Michael, Because he got that credit. And matter of fact, I was still underage and I was focusing on building my career. Mm-hmm. Well, somewhere along the line, later on, after all the 80s and stuff started subsiding and the press started getting bigger and bigger about how wonderful Michael dances, Jeffrey Daniels took the credit.
Right, Jeffrey, he did.
Jeffrey Daniels was a former Soul Train dancer.
Yep.
And when he created the group, when he joined the group Shalimar, mm-hmm. with Jody Watley and Howard Hewitt, mm-hmm. Jeffrey was actually a street dancer. So he has a song on that album, their first album, called The Pop-Along Kid. They call him The Pop-Along Kid. So the thing is, if you look at Jeffrey Daniels' song, mm-hmm. in his lyrics, he says, backslide with the smoothest ride. So Jeffrey Daniels was already doing a trendy step called the backslide. Mm-hmm. And everybody that ever sees any footage of Jeffrey Daniels, he would walk in place, he would kind of pantomime, and then he would do his famous backslide. Well, he did it enough that Michael Jackson was able to see it and utilize it for that Motown show. That Jeffrey Daniels was not, he was never listed the choreographer for the Motown 25 special. Never. Mm-hmm. It was years later, after the press attached that word moonwalk, that Jeffrey took the credit that he was teaching Michael, because nobody was policing it. Nobody was saying, okay, nobody was even questioning it, because Jeffrey was an artist on Solar Records, and Michael and Jeffrey worked together, you know, and Beat It and music videos. Mm-hmm. So people just assume, okay, well, if he's in that video, if he's over there, this is Jeffrey Daniels. But look it, Jeffrey Daniels was in Beat It, and he was in other videos in Bad, but he wasn't popping. He's not moonwalking. He's not gliding. He's doing jazz, and he's one of the street guys. So the thing is, Jeffrey ran with that credit because he could.
Right.
But later on, people really realize, okay, if you're taught by somebody, then you should look like the teacher, or your teacher should look even more advanced than you because you mm-hmm. learn from your teacher. Students are never as good as their teacher. So I'm just glad that despite running my mouth or writing something in some translation, that I put enough body of work out there that people could see what my style looked like even at 14.
Yes.
To when I mastered my own style, mm-hmm. you know, versus Jeffrey Daniels. You know what I'm saying? So I had to say that because, I kind of got lost in translation for a long time just because I was never in Michael's videos. But Jeffrey was always there.
Right.
So, and Jeffrey's listed as a choreographer in certain things later on. So, you know, people just assumed, okay, you know, Jeffrey this, Jeffrey that. And, you know, it's one of those things. You know, it doesn't make it right, but it just was one of those things. But when people see the difference in styles, then it makes all the sense in the world what's right. And not taken away from Shalimar, but I think that there's so many kids right now who have made freestyle dance and popping an art form and a way of life, that when you misdirect credit, mm-hmm. then there's no hope. Meaning Jeffrey Daniels doesn't have the Jeffrey Daniels School of the Arts. Jeffrey Daniels didn't teach any other great artists like the Jabberwockies or the World of Dance Kids or whatever. Even the new generation of people, the LXD, you know, most of the poppers who've come out, Popping John, all these great people, they're not saying, I was inspired by Jeffrey Daniels. And so when you associate yourself with the King of Pop or Michael Jackson, mm-hmm. that was a great man. You got to be great in your own right, or don't say nothing at all.
Absolutely.
It's very true.
I think the thing that stuck out to me in the documentary was when you said to look at the, you know, look at the movement. So I did go back and I, you know, I told you I was a huge fan. I thought, you know, we were getting married. You broke my heart, but okay. So I went back and I look at you do the you know, the backslide or that movement. And when I looked at it, and then I looked at Motown 25, and I said, oh my God, it was right in front of our face. You could see the similarities.
It was, well, you know what? Well, this is even better, because the whole world, everybody's just been harping on that one step. Everybody for years, the moonwalk. Guess what? I have developed a whole style. That's one move.
Yeah.
So the thing is, when you look outside that move, now we're getting better, because after Motown 25, Michael started popping.
He
started kicking. He started advancing in the art, the whole style. So by the time Dangerous came out, mm-hmm. that man was on fire. I mean, if you look at him, he was hitting, he was ticking.
He
was doing the tick walk. He was going forward, he was going backward. So it's not just one step. And you know what? It's just like any teacher. If you're a student, you're going to advance in your studies and get better. Mm-hmm. So Michael, at that time, that was appropriate that he learned the backslide, you know, and moonwalking in place, but it didn't stop there. Michael learned how to tick, he learned how to hit, he learned how to stop, you know, he learned how to pivot. So it was a whole style, you know, and people don't mm-hmm. talk about the style. They keep talking about the moonwalk. The thing is, you know, if you're going to learn an art of dance, it's just like jazz. You plie, you do bar, you do points. Mm-hmm. There's all these different levels. It's the same thing with my dance.
Absolutely. So, again, you have influenced so many people and such basically a generation. What do you think your legacy will be?
You know what? I want my legacy to be that no matter what color I was or where I came from, mm-hmm. that God gave me a talent that surpassed my skin color and helped other people look beyond just this black guy and looked at me as just an interesting human being. I'm at the age now where I hope that my legacy is that I was trying to be an instrument for God, you know, and helping people look at their fellow man mm-hmm. as an equal, not a lesser person, you know, because we live in a world, we live for decades. We have segregation, we have fingers pointing at those people or this race. There's always something. It's just races, different races of people point and they try to demean and lessen the humanity of another human. And so with dance, I was able, me and Michael Jackson and others, with our talent, we were able to reach people of other nationalities. Because God created everybody equal, right?
Right.
So as long as people put music on, they would shut up and dance and stop harping on race or color. So you know what? I just hope that beyond my legacy, that I would be just one of those people who stepped up to the plate to let people know at the end of the day, we're only human. You know, just like Michael's song, Human Nature.
Mm-hmm.
You know, at least that God gave me a talent that I shared with others so that we have at least something in common, right?
Right, absolutely. So, since this is MJ all day, what's something that we don't know about Michael Jackson?
Well, the only thing that I can share
mm-hmm.
is just be the last time I was with Michael,
mm-hmm.
Michael hired me to do the choreography for Do the Bartman. Michael wrote a song, Do the Bartman, for Gracie Films, The Simpsons,
mm-hmm.
Sing the Blues. And so Michael, this was 1990. Michael had asked me, you know, he wanted to get out of the city because, I mean, everybody was pretty much just following him and, you know, it was just kind of like really bad. He couldn't go anywhere without it being pandemonium. So he said, you know what, I want you to come and do the choreography at Neverland. So I was invited to Neverland.
Mm-hmm.
So me and my wife at the time, we went to Neverland and, the thing is, I spent the weekend there, of course, not in his house, but he had a guest cottage, for the record. He wasn't weird. So, yeah, we had a guest cottage separate from where he lived. And when it was time for me to rehearse, we rehearsed. And after the rehearsal, I didn't get in his business. I just went back home. So, that for the record, yeah, I was in this party, right?
Right.
So, the thing is, I wasn't looking for anything but what I needed to do my work, go home, and shut up. So, that's the truth. So,
right. So
as we're doing the choreography and getting everything ready, he chose to have it on the weekend. So by the end of the weekend, he was able to videotape what we came up with for the steps for Bart Simpson so that he could send it to the animators.
Mm-hmm.
And so when he sent what we did at his ranch, the video to the animators, then that's the steps for Bart Simpson when he was dancing. What I noticed in that weekend that I spent with Michael, I told my wife, I go, you know what? He seems very lonely. He seems very lonely, and he had like a really weird sadness. Mm-hmm. And I shared that with her because he had all this new property. He had his zoo, you know, he had his lions, he had his giraffes, Kareem Abdul and Jabbar. He had his chimps, Max and Alex, you know, he had everything. But when we were having dinner, I just couldn't help but just watch him, and I was just looking at him. It was very sad because he looked very lonely. Mm-hmm. He looked very lonely. And I say this because he was around a lot of people that were on a salary. They weren't his family members. Right. The maids and the people who kept the grounds, those were not his family. He was a different person when he was in Encino because he was with his mom and his brothers and his sisters. Mm-hmm. But now I seen a different Michael that was kind of sad and kind of, he didn't look happy like somebody that's, wow, you know, this is my house, man, I want my people. Right. He looked like, okay, you know what, I have all this stuff, but there was something that was missing, and that you can't put a price on family and the comfort of your mom. You just can't. And that was mama's pearl. I mean, he was always mama's pearl. Mm-hmm. So the thing is, I think now that I reflect back on everything, you know, if he had to just say, hey, look, I want to go back with my mom, or at least have her somewhere on the property, I think she could have kept him spiritually grounded, like in tune with God and and with peace, and maybe content with simpler things. Mm-hmm. But I think the Hollywood machine and the entertainment thing was a little bit overwhelming for him to just try to handle by himself, you know. And you know, it was kind of sad, you know, just to see all that stuff, and then him just had this look that he had like a sadness, like he was lonely, right. You know, I hate to say it, but he just really looked like it was all business and no pleasure, you know. And so the things that I see later that remind me of what he found pleasure in, you know, he had his amusement park, he had his animals, which he couldn't touch because he said he had an allergy. You know, he had theater, he had fun stuff, he had young people. You know, laughter of children kind of tries to bring you up, right? And you could be silly and make crazy sounds or whatever, but I think that he tried to surround himself with things that bring joy.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
But nothing can replace your family.
That's true.
You could get a Wi-Fi, you can get a new device, whatever, but nothing replaces your family. That's and true. Isolation is not good for anyone, so I think that at the end of the day, everybody saw, everybody was just turning on him or whatever. He wasn't around people that cared about him. Nope. They were like, no, Michael, this, I want some money, you know?
Yeah, absolutely. I agree.
It's very true.
I agree.
So that's something I never shared, but you asked a question, what's something that nobody knows? Well, maybe people heard this, you know, bits and pieces of whatever I said, but the bottom line is they've never heard it from me. So you asked me the question, and that's for me. Then hopefully there was something that, you know, for his family or his fans or whatever that weren't there with us that will know, okay, you know what? Wow, this was beautiful, because that's a piece of him. That's a piece of him and a piece of history with that man, you know, that I'm just putting out there, you know, for his family first, and then other people who did care about him, you know?
Yeah. And I just wanted to say one other thing, because you said it in your documentary, and I just want you to touch on it, about how instrumental he was in you getting credit at some point for some work that you had done.
I got to clear this up. Okay. Yeah. So look, for the record, you touched on a big reason why I didn't work that much and why people weren't even looking at me the right way as far as respectful, you know, what my contribution was. Mm-hmm. Just because Jeffrey Daniels had that credit on lock, and then on top of it, you know, he was a choreographer and in his videos, so that was documented. Mm-hmm. So people were like, okay, well, it must be true. Anybody else is just fake, right? So the thing is, by the time he asked me to work on the Bart Simpson, I remember his secretary at the time was Norma Steichel. Mm-hmm. And, you know, when she asked me that Michael wanted to work with me, you know, I was a grown man, and I said, okay, you know what? I got to tell this guy something. So, you know, me and Michael were talking. I said, Michael, he's like, yes. I go, I gotta share something with you that's bothering me. He goes, what is it? What happened? I'm like, well, I go, for years, people keep questioning whether I taught you or not. I go, I'm getting tired of trying to prove it. It's hard, dude. I go, you're super famous, and who am I? A Joe Schmo. I go, I gotta, you know, I would really appreciate it if somehow or another you could do something to get credit. He goes, consider it done.
I love it.
He goes, wait, consider it done. So he had his people write a thing on Do the Bartman. Mm-hmm. He made sure to send them a direct message that I was going to get credit. And to this day, I thank myself for having the courage to speak up, because somebody that powerful and somebody that famous, sometimes you don't want to say anything to make your boss mad, right?
Right,
like, I ain't
going to
say nothing, right? You know, but I was like, okay, the squeaky wheel won't get his oil. Better say something.
Right.
So I'm just glad. I'm glad that I told him to vouch for me, because now it's on record. Now it was on record. When you look at the Simpsons Sing the Blues, Do the Bartman, it's not just Wikipedia. Somebody did that, and that would thank the person who did it. But on the Simpsons Sing the Blues, Michael made sure that my name, Michael Chambers, not Boogaloo Shrimp,
right,
my birth name, my state name, is on that project as the choreographer, which means if I put the choreography together, I had to have worked out with him, and there goes a piece of the pie. After all those years, I was able as a choreographer, but now it gives validity to the other times that I didn't get credit.
Right.
It was kind of beyond the Bart Simpson. Bart Simpson's an animated cartoon.
Mm-hmm.
But for him to give me that credit was kind of like validating, this guy has been working with me in my camp. I mean, the Jackson camp was very secret. So after all those years, I had to wait, but I ain't complaining because it's very true. He finally vouched for me and he put my name there. So I'm kind of glad, because to get the credit in 1990, and I told you we first met in 1982, that's a long time to be getting information from somebody that you're working with, right?
Absolutely.
And it makes all the sense in the world because it's true.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, I thank you so much for your time.
Thank you so much, Miss Riley. I hope this helps people, especially his family, you know, because, I mean, this is a time, especially COVID-19, where people need to heal and hear something good and positive. Mm-hmm. Hopefully, this will be a positive memory for people in his family, you know, and people who did care about him to say, yeah, you know what, this was something good that I heard that's very true and it made me feel good, you know?
Absolutely. I think it will be. Thank you so much for being a part of it. After checking out this podcast, go to www.boogalooshrimpdocumentary.com. That's www.boogalooshrimpdocumentary.com. So you can check us out at mjallday.thepodcast on Facebook and mjallday-thepodcast on Twitter. You can also email me at dthevip@gmail.com. That's dthevip@gmail.com, and tell me all of your MJ stories.
Beneath the Eiffel Tower, in Ghana's Black Star Square, in Johannesburg and in Pittsburgh, in Birmingham, Alabama, and Birmingham, England, we are missing Michael. But we do know that we had him. And we are the world.